Good afternoon. It's always interesting to be really the last one. I want to talk about a story. Actually, I've got a story to tell about what happened the last year in the Netherlands. And to begin that story, I want to take you back to 2007, when Carsten Knoll disclosed that the MyFair Classic chip was no longer trustworthy. Not long thereafter, the University of Nijmegen totally broke the algorithm, and it was clear that RFID technology was not to be trusted, except for bureaucrats. They kept believing that the system was safe. And they introduced a card in the Netherlands. They have been building that for actually since the early 1990s, and even before that they tried to build a similar system. They've tried to build a system based where you pay with your RFID card. You get on the bus, you check in, you get off the bus, you check out. It is kind of similar in a lot of cities. Only one thing in the Netherlands is different. We have a whole bunch of transportation companies. And they all have different rules and different wishes, and they want to work differently with it. So the system grew big and expensive. According to a report out of 2004, if the total introduction had been completed in 2007, the price tag would stand at 3 billion euros. However, we only completed the system this year. When the problem started with the MyFair Classic, also a second discussion started. A second discussion based on, is it normal that there is a company in the Netherlands that knows when you get on a bus, when you get off, where you get on that bus, at what time, and is it normal that this data is being stored for 7 years? The discussion was mainly raised in the hacking community and not really outside of it. When I was in 1989, I was a kid and I went to East Berlin. Actually, I went to Eastern Europe. And at a certain point, one of the teachers told me that I shouldn't be afraid if we were getting on the bus and somebody was standing there taking a photo and making some notes. He would work for the Stasi, and that is what they did in Eastern Germany. And here we are, the Dutch, basically not debating a whole system that keeps track of you every movement, getting on the trams, on the subway, on the buses, on the trains, and there's no public debate about it. I'm an investigative journalist, and at that point, I think it's your obligation to start investigating and to start raising the discussion, because it's strange if nobody does that. But it's kind of hard to do, because in the Netherlands, the main opinion is, if there's nothing to hide, there's nothing to worry about. So I took a different approach, and I focused on the whole security problem with the card. Carsten said it was broken. Carsten said that several times. And Carsten was pretty convincing. So most people were convinced. Scientists, technologists, bunch of journalists, but not Parliament. Parliament believed that the OV chip card, as the system is called, is still very safe. It's trustworthy. And if something goes wrong and somebody starts defrauding the system, within 24 hours this card will be blocked. And there's nothing to worry about. When somebody from the University of Nijmegen questioned that, he was invited in Parliament to talk about it, and he dared to question that. At that point, basically the politicians said that they didn't believe him, that he was exaggerating. So first you invite him, then he gives his opinion, and then Parliament says, well, we don't like your answers, so they must be wrong. For me, that was the day that I knew that there would be a day that I would be traveling on these cards. So 1 year later, I heard that people were traveling, and actually in quite a few numbers. And the one downside of it was that all the tools were based on Linux. And for many people, that's not easy to grasp. Until mid last year, all of a sudden there were tools for Windows available. And they had been circulating for a while. I had been writing and reporting about it consistently. And time after time after time, the answer was that there was nothing to worry about, and I was exaggerating, and those tools, they don't exist. So, realizing what the consequence would be of me traveling on those cards, I started writing articles explaining that it was technically possible, that there were tools available, that I could read the card, and anybody who knows that you can read an RFID card knows that at that point, probably you can write it as well. But everybody stayed in denial. So I started preparing to travel, and one of the things I realized was that if you do it, you got to do it once, and you got to do it good. And then basically it's over and you can't do that again. So what I started to do was first analyzing the situation, and I realized that traveling on a card is not enough. At a certain point the card will be blocked and everybody will say, hey, the system works. But then you have to realize, how do they block a card? They write a bit on that card, the card that is cracked. So why not put an old dumb back and then basically you have unlocked the card again. So after 24 hours people will lock the card and then it will be unlocked by me again. I'll make one more write and basically I've made my point. But meanwhile investigating, I learned that the Dutch railways had a list of blocked cards. So you can't check in with them again. But then you have to think, what do they do? What do you want to do? There's basically one point you want to survive. And that is the point where the train conductor walks by, reads the card, and then says, okay, you're checked in and everything is okay. So I found a way of checking myself in. Well, basically I took a status of I'm checked in and started changing the status. Changing the train station, changing the date, changing... basically, you could change anything you wanted to change. With some help here last year, we wrote an application and where I could check myself in, make just a dump, and then put that back on the card. So as soon as I got back from CCC last year, I started traveling. But then the scary part happened, that after 24 hours, my card wasn't blocked. Not after 48 hours, not after 72, etc. And no matter what I did, the card was never blocked. So at a certain point, I've written my article, the magazine goes to print, you get nervous, because I still got other tests to run. So I started get in a bus, check in, then talk to the driver, like, is this the bus to blah, blah, blah. And when he said no, you walked out and I checked in again. So I had, like, at a certain point, 25 checked in statuses. And the next day the card wasn't blocked. Then I started making trips that are totally illogic, but the card wasn't blocked. I started working with multiple cards, but it wasn't blocked. And at that point I really started to panic, because I really wanted to do the full Monty. So at a certain point I went to Schiphol Airport, which is the main national airport, and that's the one place in the Netherlands where we have 30,000 cameras. So if you behave ridiculously, they must notice it. So I cheered for the camera, sat down, and started cracking my card. Next to me came a train conductor. He asked me what I was doing, if this was one of those internet devices so that you could use online internet. So I went like, yeah, sure, that's typically what it is, and it works like a charm. And he had no clue. I checked myself in Maastricht, which is the south part of the country, which is 200 kilometers away, and put the time back 3 minutes. And then checked out. Which is totally impossible. Then in the Netherlands what happens is at the train station you've got to wait for 3 minutes and then you can try it again. So I did that 12 times, a full hour long. So the next morning I checked in and I thought like, okay, now it will be blocked. And it wasn't blocked. So I thought like, okay, go back to the airport again and repeat the same trick. Maybe, you know, if I do it for 2 hours, that will work. But then I wanted to check out, and all of a sudden, the card was blocked. And behind me were two cops, and they were looking at me, so I went like, it doesn't work. And they said like, well, we don't work for the railway, so don't bother us with it. I sat down, I unlocked my card, and got on the bus and could travel again. And then I managed to get two blocked cards that way, and with those two blocked cards, I've been checking myself in the train as well. So for 1 week, train conductors would come by, this card is blacklisted, and they wouldn't notice it. And this company wants to play for a bank, which is really interesting. Then we went public, and I went public together with somebody who's sitting there, Jeroen Wollaars. He's with the state broadcaster, and we made a trip with cameraman and everything. Of course, everything went fine. They noticed nothing. There was a debate in parliament, promised. And as soon as we got live, the company said like, oh yeah, but we knew all along and we were just watching what you were doing. So I prepared them already, if they ask that question, ask how many cards I used. Because if you know everything, it can't be that hard to discover how many cards I used. Of course, they refused to answer that question, and the next remark was, oh yeah, and we pressed charges. But nobody could find the charges, so we left it at that. But then, that evening, I saw the stupidity of the response and the aggressive way, because they said like, yeah, you know, defrauding a card is illegal, so you shouldn't do it. So I phoned Jeroen again and said like, why don't we bring the second story as well, that I can check myself in. And then the opening of the news was really nice, because the company before that wanted to respond to everything, and now all of a sudden it was, the company refuses to respond. End of story. There was a debate in parliament, an investigation was launched that later led to enforcement of changes into the system, but they still have to be enforced. And I think you kind of kill the light. That's a little bit much, but there we are. But basically, everything was left at that, and things turned silent, the dust came down again, and life went on, and it was June when all of a sudden there was a letter from the public prosecutor. And they said that they realized that I was a journalist, but they suspected I had committed a crime. Something to do with the transportation cards. First mistake, they didn't say what they suspected I did exactly. But I had to come for interrogation, so the next morning I was still kind of relaxed. I phoned a lawyer. She panicked, and I had to show up at the police station, and then the lawyer prepared me, like, you are aware that you might not go home in the evening. So that was the first time that it struck, like, oh my God, this is really serious. But the district attorney already promised he won't go to jail because there's only one suspicion. So as soon as I set foot in the room, they said, oh yeah, and we're adding two suspicions. Hacking and having tools to hack. So that was kind of four nerve-wracking hours. Long story short, basically they've discovered that I was traveling on transportation cards, that I had been manipulating them, but they only had half of the evidence. Like, the other half was just not there. There were no images of, for instance, Jeroen. They were not in the file. It was something that later turned out to be the case. They only knew of a couple of trips I made, but on the same card I made other trips that were never discovered. So the system, it proved again that the system failed dramatically. And what was kind of interesting as well was that at certain points, I prepared a statement, and at certain points, I told more than they basically knew based on their research. At the end, it would turn out they had 5 detectives working on the case, and the case had a name. It was called Operation Device. Like you're some kind of drugs criminal, a warlord, I don't know ever what they thought. But in the end, they came to the conclusion that I was a journalist, and that I went public with the story in a journalistic way, so you're allowed to break the law. But that only took for them 5 months to find out. Those 5 months, I have to pay a lawyer. And that's really a nice lady, but as soon as you step into a room, she starts to pronounce how much she is. And I can tell you, a hooker is cheaper. So there you are, and all of a sudden it strikes me like, hey, I'm self-employed. This might easily go to trial, and then it will cost me 50 to 100,000 euros. And if I have to appeal, at least double. And I don't have that money. And if you're convicted, ultimately I want to take that to the European Court of Justice or the European Court of Human Rights, because this is a really important thing. So I started shouting that I had a problem, and then there were a couple of media, 3 I work for, and one blog that started a fundraiser. And we asked for 2,500 euros to cover the first costs. That took 58 minutes to collect. And over the next days thereafter, there was at least 5,000 euros added to it. So that was really amazing. And later on, the district attorney said, like, well, we didn't see that one coming. So that definitely helped, because the fact that you're a journalist, the question is if what you do is relevant for the society. So if society starts to donate you money, apparently what you did was relevant. When the case was dropped, another case started, and that was a whole different story. I'll come back to the transportation card in my forward-looking statement in a second. That was called Did You Notar? I was sitting on a train, paid for my ride, and I got a phone call of somebody explaining that there was this guy in Iran and he was going to Gmail but was ending up at the wrong service. That can only mean one thing. If you're a little bit technical, you understand what's happening. There's something wrong with SSL. So there's something wrong with certificates. And let's cut a long story short. That's technically impossible. It just cannot happen. Because certificates are issued in a certain way, everything is separated. It is technically fully impossible that this happened. And yet this was confirmed. So I got out of the train, started typing on an article called the Department of the Interior, and in a funny mode said, okay, in which room is the crisis management talk? And they went like, what? And they were not aware of the issue at all. After the next few days, it turned out that DigiNotar was a certificate provider that was hacked. But because they were hacked, the hacker could generate a lot of certificates himself. Certificates were typically star.google.com, star.microsoft.com, windowsupdate.microsoft.com, a lot of blogs, a lot of Israeli blogs. There were sites for other software updates. Basically everything you want to do as a government. It's kind of maybe too light. Oh, you're okay. Oh, it's hacked. It's okay. Basically, everything was there to do what a government would want to do, and that is monitor their people. And with Iran, that is a very dangerous thing. And out of sources, I understood that there were 300,000 people monitored, which means that the bunch of the Iranians is not being monitored. So apparently the Iranians can divide groups in bad citizens and good citizens. This is your absolutely worst nightmare. There was a report written, and it turned out that basically there were a couple of mistakes made. The vault that was never to be opened was continuously open. It was totally forbidden to have a direct network link between the system that generates the certificates and the rest of the network. Well, it was hooked up to the same Windows network, to the same domain. They didn't use antivirus. Some antivirus was not updated properly. Basically, this company was your every worst nightmare. So when Mozilla got the word, they threatened to retract all the certificates. And then the country can do one thing, and that is basically not trust this company anymore. This company had a second function. It was giving out certificates on behalf of the state of the Netherlands. So these were government-issued certificates as well. So you cannot trust government websites no more. This led, of course, to a hearing in Parliament. I was heard, Rob Groenkrijp was heard, a lot of other experts, people that were involved. And at a certain point, one of the politicians asked me, Mr. De Winter, you've been writing about it so a lot, making such a fuss about it, but this is just an incident. And at that time, I thought, okay, this is game over. Let's do totally different. For 30 years, we've tried to do it a nice way. Writing an article if there's a leak and then explaining what the leak is, etc. Maybe it's time that we show the number, the real impact of all these leaks. And I was triggered by something else. In July, we had a leak at a dating website where all the data was put on Pastebin. And that's kind of painful if you're dating, for instance, with your work address. It's stupid that they use the work email for it, but it happens. And that really didn't get the media attention it deserved. So ultimately, what I decided, was that we should really show something else. Well, did you know that happened in September? And it came October, so I thought, like, why not call October Leaktober? And we'll show a leak in a government website or a business website each and every day of the week. Not in the weekend, because, you know, people need some rest as well. And we started off with one leak in the authentication system of the Dutch government. It showed that if you have a cross-site scripting leak in your website, you could clone a session. I would call that pretty shocking, but not for the Dutch government. They said, like, don't worry about it, because then you still need a website that is vulnerable for a cross-site scripting leak. So the next day, I showed 7 of those websites. The day after, I showed 50. That was end of discussion on that one, and we showed some other leaks. There were 2 ground rules. One, it had to be privacy-sensitive information. 2, it had to be something where we didn't ask for it, or if they came to us, we would never ever say, download the database. And sometimes that means bad luck for you as well. Suppose that you get information on a hospital where somebody has access to 219 databases. You know for a fact that there must be privacy-sensitive data. But we can't prove it, so we never ran the story. But we had other things as well. For instance, we had this this flight school, AIS Flight Academy. They were leaking name, address, date of birth, place, photo, passport number, date of issue of the passport, end date for the passport, place of issuance of the passport, your social security number, your financial status, and your crime record. What else do you need to commit identity theft. Well, maybe your bank account, thank God it was there as well. This flight school reacted basically by saying that I was extorting money out of them and threatened to press charges. From what I understand, they tried to do that, but police explained to them that maybe they violated the law as well, and it would not be a wise idea to go that route. Another example was Cheap Tickets. Cheap Tickets is a company that sells flight tickets, as the name suggests, and they promise to be cheap, but they turn out to be cheap in their security mainly. They leaked a database of 715,000 people of unneeded data, because it was between 1 and 2 years old. And the database was just put in place there to do some testing. And how do you do testing in a totally unsecured environment where everybody can get to it? I phoned Jeroen with the story, and I could tell him on which flight he had been on recently and what his meal preference of his wife was. So that was quite convincing, I guess. But it shows how totally ridiculous it is, because there was no security whatsoever. Then, all of a sudden, there came this story of 50 cities that had their website hacked. Those 50 cities were residing on one server, not adequately protected, because they had a command box that you could reach through the internet. So I could type in comments and just walk through all the sites. The thing was, this thing was also reported to a weblog that is not known for their subtleness. Geen Stel, it's called. And they wanted to publicize. And if they publish, they publish right away. But I couldn't oversee the consequences, because what else is on those sites? And it's definitely information that involves civilians. And you can't oversee the risk. So I phoned the Association of Cities, and they said, like, good point. What we should do is take down the websites. So they tried to call the emergency net. But in the Netherlands, they never thought that an IT incident might be a reason to call an alarm. So they didn't know how to do it. Then I tried to call the organization responsible for security in the Netherlands when the government is involved, GovCert. But yeah, it's Saturday, and on Saturday security incidents don't happen. So ultimately, I ended up calling the Secret Service. And they explained to me, well, listen, this is not really the matter of national security. So, and I know, but I don't know what else to do, and Geen Stel will publish. And they ultimately took some measures, and all of a sudden the websites went down. And in a fully legal way, that nothing was wrong there, but all of a sudden things got rolling. Story was published, was a big deal. And then all of a sudden 16 cities got up and said, like, whoa, wait. There's nothing wrong with our site, because this is our old site and we just forgot to clean it. So there's nothing wrong here. There were social security numbers on there, sessions were there, fully backups of their entire systems were there. But they didn't consider that to be a problem. Then the hacker came to me and he handed me one password list. And on the password list were the accounts of the city workers and of one of the responsible people there. She was called Winifred, and her password was Pooh Bear. Just showing how painful sometimes a password can be. But also was there, from the local broadcaster, there were a couple of accounts there, and they had the full passwords there. So I phoned them, like, I've got a cool story for you. The city, you know, the next door, this and this and this happened. Shouldn't we do something together? And they went like, oh, yeah. So when I was in the interview, the cameras were rolling, I asked her for a name, and she gave her name. And then I said, like, well, and your password is this and this. And then the story took a whole different turn, because all of a sudden, what the fuck does a local government do with the passwords of a broadcaster? Now it turned out that it was an email mailing list. And for the email mailing list, they used first name, last name, date of birth, home address, email address, of course, else you can't send an email, and your password. And it showed also that it's kind of painful that you collect so much information if you only need this little bit. Strange story, but okay, I left it at that. 24 hours later, there was another email from the hacker with another password list of one of those 16 cities. And we started calling it the Big Mouth cities because they were compromised, there was an incident, and basically what happened was that there was more going down than they were willing to admit. After the third list, all of a sudden I got a letter from a city down south in the Netherlands, basically telling me that I was financially responsible for everything that would happen in their city. It was not limited to an IT incident or whatsoever. But I never got the letter in time because there was a deadline of 5 o'clock on Friday afternoon that I had to promise not to write about that city ever again. But I got the letter at 5:25. I knew it before because everybody in the world knew it. There was this regional newspaper that phoned me and they said, like, what are you going to do now? So I'm like, well, it's 4:45 and my dog is jumping, so I guess I'm going to walk the dog if that's okay with you. And there was this weblog that had access to the document, anybody but me. So I got it 25 minutes too late, and then, of course, nothing happened. I got a lawyer involved because you never know if there is a risk, and basically he told me there was nothing to worry about. Ultimately, the mayor was to the point that he wanted to retract the letter, but then the local city council sent out a press release in which they... except for one political party, all political parties said that it is good to threaten journalists in these cases. So now he couldn't retract the letter because the city council basically told him not to do that. So ultimately we came to the following agreement. The letter is not retracted, but all content is removed. So there's only my name and address, and then Dear Mr. De Winter, and then signed by the mayor of that city. And that was the end. And of course, he had to pay for my lawyer. So we saw a whole bunch of these incidents that were getting stranger and stranger and stranger, and it was more and more data that got involved. I got a couple of threats during the process. Of course, a couple of, I'm going to call my lawyer. So then you can say, like, okay, tell him I said hi. One time I was beaten by somebody that was angry, and some people threatened to do nasty stuff to me. So that is how the Netherlands in general apparently deals with security incidents. But Parliament got involved and they promised to do a better job. Now, several of my cases and several of other cases have led to the conclusion that something needs to be done in ICT. So in the Netherlands now we are going to get a parliamentary investigation into failing ICT. I wish them a lot of luck with that. But that's at least one of the things we achieved. I'm just checking if I'm not forgetting. Oh yeah, there's one other interesting leak. One of the category that has consistently problems with their security apparently are medical facilities. And we had a lot of reports of medical leaks, and that amazes me because you always expect that your medical data is safe, but apparently that is not the case. When the month was over, I realized something else. And the month is not totally over because there's another story to tell, but I realized something else. I had done this for the entire month of October, and at a certain point, 2 weeks before that and 1 week after that, there wasn't a single leak that was placed on Pastebin. Anonymous and Lulzsec had totally been silenced. And of course, we never ever published personal data because we are after the protection and not after and trying to get attention for it. Everybody knew the word Leaktober. So everybody knew all of a sudden there was something with security and it's not looking good. So those are a couple of things that were achieved. However, the end of the month was kind of funny, because all of a sudden it turned out that somebody had put some effort in looking at my website. And it turned out that I was used software that was kind of old, but they found a zero day in it. And they went public with it. That was, of course, a riot. I, of course, acknowledged that it was not correct to use old software, but on my account, there was no personal data involved. And if you add up all the numbers of the people that were hit by all these incidents, you talk about millions of people. It all started with DigiNota. After Leaktober, somebody came to me and he said that another provider of certificates was having security issues. Gemnet. So he was doing his research and then said, like, take it, go live now, because there's at least one other hacker active at the same machine. And this is something we tend to forget as well. They all say, like, there's no reason to suspect that anything has been done with your data. You don't know that. Gemnet, the server will be up somewhere this week, I believe. I have not checked if they put it back up, but there were no certificates ultimately involved. But we also had another story, and that's still evolving. KPN, the Dutch, the biggest supplier of certificates right now in the Netherlands, and also Telco, they have retracted more than 1,000 certificates in less than 1 month's time. They say it has to do with spelling errors, but they refuse to show us which domains are involved, what is really happening. So that is still something that is ongoing. And that basically shows that we're still not aware enough and not active enough in protecting the people. And I would like to remember you that I started telling that dissidents' lives were at stake. This is really a matter of life and death. And if you still don't believe it, I asked for documents on security incidents in the Netherlands, and the organization that arranges that, GovCert, they've lost all incidents before 2008. They can't find that, so they don't know what the hell they did over those 8 years, from 2000 to 2008. And from 2009 to 2011, they had 14 incidents where if it would become public what happened there, our national security would immediately be at risk. So maybe in this room somebody is sitting on knowledge that could put my life at risk. So security is not a funny thing anymore. All of a sudden you realize that there is really something going on. That basically led me to the conclusion that we have to do a lot more for next year. And am I going to travel at the public transportation card for free once more? Probably yes. They have introduced a new card, but it's still using the MiFi Classic technology. But they put a firewall in front of it. And that's just fine, because then you can't crack that card anymore. Now let's pray that I'll never find the master key, because then it doesn't matter if there is a firewall in front of it or not. So they basically replaced the technology with broken technology by design. And as Bruce Schneier once already said, leaks don't get better, leaks only get worse. So yes, that's probably what will happen next year. What will we see next year as well? Well, one of the things is that in the Netherlands, organizations consistently refuse to live up to standards like ISO 27001 and 2. It's obliged to do so by the Dutch government for government organizations, but I'm still looking for the first one that is certified. If you process credit card numbers, you have to live up to the PCI standard, PCI 5 to be correct. That forbids that you have a credit card number that is readable in the database. Early January, I'll show that that is something that is a little bit too difficult for some organizations. And that raises the question how it can be that credit card organizations mandate a PCI audit and that these audits failed, just as they failed in the case of DigiNota. What did those auditors do? I have really no clue, but that is what the reality is. On a personal level, something very nice happened because all the work and all the attention that all of a sudden was evolving in the Netherlands for security led to the nomination of Journalist of the Year. And all of a sudden, ICT is not dirty anymore in the Netherlands, at least not to write about it or to report about it. So. So it also shows that if you really do your best, you can make a difference and you can make a change. I acknowledge that we're definitely not done, but it's something that is moving. At this point, government workers are complaining to me because citizens are asking them nasty questions. Yesterday I was at Business News Radio in the Netherlands and they asked me, what can a citizen do if they don't trust it? So I went like, call your local government, ask them, what do you do to protect my privacy? And that is, of course, what people should do a lot more. You're maintaining my data, I see these leaks, I get nervous about it. What are you doing? It's not journalism that can do everything for you. So you have to get yourself, you have to get involved. And last but not least, probably what we will see next year is that that we'll get a cyber warfare center in the Netherlands. We have the strange notion in the Netherlands that if you spend 50 million euros at cyber warfare, that we will be protected from everything. I can tell you that reality now is that if you send a broken PDF to an average government worker, you take over the network. So I don't know what this center will do, and maybe they do counterattacks of something very intelligent, but I would start by patching my systems. With Leaktober, most systems were not patched at all. Most systems were running software where patches were available, leaks were known, and they weren't patched. Another problem in the Netherlands is that we have an authority that watches over privacy and is meant to enforce the law. They employ 80 people. Let me remind you of my criminal case where 5 detectives were looking into the matter for 5 months. So imagine what happens if you have to go to a company and analyze that. We have animal police in the Netherlands. We have 500 cops for that. So that shows how serious we are about privacy. And this morning it was news in the Netherlands that Dutch police has started a project where they will use all available open source intelligence, meaning scraping the websites, linking that to people in order to make people, the police, able to prevent crime from happening at all. There's this little book called 1984. I want to leave it at that. But this is the reality at this point, and it shows that we are a nation in dire need of people that dare to stand up and dare to be critical to the government. And there's a problem as well. IT journalism and investigative journalism is in a very sorrow place. That's really something that keeps me up at night, because if not a few people pick up on a file and start working on it, it won't happen. With Leaktober, I got 270 organizations or leaks reported to me, unique leaks. I can't cover them all. It's just that simple, you know. Some of them you can relate to the organization and say, like, your system is toast. And they got away lucky because it's not reported. But that's not enough. People need to know that their data was at stake and it was not protected. There's a second thing starting in the Netherlands. Next year, the Dutch government will open up their center at the Department of Justice where hackers can report leaks. And they will keep it silent. So there won't be any reporting about it. So that's convenient for the companies. The less convenient part is that you stop learning from each other. A basic part in security. So that is going to be interesting. And Parliament voted against whistleblower protection in the Netherlands for hackers. So if you're going to report to the Department of Justice, remember what the Department of Justice did to me before you start reporting. And I would go to the media if I were you. Because there's a big interest in openness about leaks and what's happening to our privacy. It's not about the feeling that our data is good, it's about that our data needs to be good. And last but not, and that's really the last point I want to make for next year, and then it's time for questions and stuff. I've got a clue that a lot of Dutch data already ended up in the United States under the Patriot Act. If there are any Germans in the room, I would start asking about what your government is sending to the United States, because I wouldn't be in a comfortable place. So that's the story I had to tell, or wanted to tell. I don't know if there are any questions.
Little bit over 10 minutes left for questions, so I'll just...
Oh, that's good.
...come over to you quickly.
Thank you. Hi, I have this feeling that it only gets worse. I mean, not only leaks, just everything only gets worse, right? There was this strategy that we should try to work with the government or try to work with the admins of the pages that have leaks. Then it generally doesn't work, right? They don't listen. They report the hackers the whistleblowers to the police. It doesn't work. Then I thought, we could basically just sit back and wait for all this, the hit fit the shan, right? Not to use bad words. But then, actually shit hit the fan with the DigiNotar, right? And I thought, well, this is as bad as it gets. I don't think it can, and now I'm just lost for ideas. What can be the strategy now, right? Obviously all the strategies we had don't work.
It can get a lot worse. I don't know if nuclear missiles are controlled by SCADA systems, but that would be my worst nightmare, I guess. You have to imagine that governments are filled with techno-optimists. Those are people that believe that technology only brings good solutions and there are no problems attached to it. You saw it with the overchip card, you saw it with the websites. It's modern technology, so it should be good. So that definitely won't lead to a different attitude. If you sit down and wait for the disaster to happen, people in this case in Iran are at stake. Should they be the victim of us being too arrogant to do our security properly? I don't think so. So you can't sit back and relax, unfortunately. You have to do something. I don't have the silver bullet of solving this issue, but I noticed that by gaining attention for it, you can put it on the agenda and you can get something done. And you can techno-optimists look like fools, and that's always a fun place to be.
I like to story. The data protection regulator in the UK, the Information Commissioner's Office, actually has stated on their website that you should contact the company you have a problem with before you contact them, which is going to allow many people to actually just fix the leak and they're not getting trouble for being lax in security in the first place. So some time ago when I googled my Google search for my IP address, I found a list of search terms for a medical information website, one on behalf of the government. And so the medical information commissioner to the regulator and the company, the problem is fixed quickly after I fixed it, but the regulator came back after a few months and asked us for further details. Very, very slow indeed. A few months for a leak of medical search terms with IP addresses.
Well, some of the leaks of Leaktober still haven't been fixed.
Yes.
And are still leaking data. The Dutch regulator can't take on that many cases because there are only 80 people working there. You have to cut out some staff for press contacts, for secretary jobs, that type of stuff. So the investigators are a small number of people. We have 900,000 companies in the Netherlands. So what do you expect from them? You know, they will go after the company that makes the overchip card because it's in the news and it looks good on television that they did something about it. And that's just about it. Oh yeah, and they go after Google because that also looks good in the media. But all the other companies get away with it. And you know, if you get caught in the Netherlands, the biggest fine you can get is €4,500. So it pays off to be a criminal in the Netherlands.
And it's not just information technology. Where I've worked, I've been charged of a load of boxes of paper files. And so the managers propose a system where we just give them to every council employee, government employee who asks for them.
Okay, any more questions? No, none. Okay, well then we are done. Thank you, Breno.